turning, milling, drilling, tapping, and 3D printing. Without any professional background, how difficult is it to build an RC excavator from scratch? Aluminum sheets, plastic, and steel. With just amateur-level equipment, how can I turn them into professional-grade parts for an RC excavator? Welcome to the third episode. This is my challenge to hand-build an RC excavator from scratch. In this video, I will complete the boom, stick, and bucket. This is the 3D assembly design I drew. Both the boom and stick have a symmetrical left and right structure. The first and third layers are non-load-bearing, purely decorative parts, and will be made using 3D printing. The second layer is the main load-bearing structure, which will be made from 3mm thick aluminum plates. The two aluminum plates are connected by these cylindrical parts to form a unified structure. These parts are the ears for mounting the hydraulic cylinders made of aluminum alloy. The bucket will also be made using 3D printing. This design looks a bit complex, but it's the result of balancing various factors like existing processes, materials, function, and appearance. If you have a better solution, feel free to leave a comment. According to my plan, I'll be using this CNC router to machine the aluminum plates for the boom and stick. Unfortunately, I forgot to record the machining process. This photo was taken after the machining was finished. This 20mm diameter aluminum bar will be used to make these cylindrical connectors. These parts may look simple, but they are actually the most difficult to machine in this episode, even more so than the irregularly shaped ears. The machine doing the heavy lifting is my mini lathe. I've modified the lathe with an electronic gearbox and added DRO. In a previous video, I also made a quick change tool post for it. After the initial machining, I switched to the milling machine to process the threaded pilot holes. They are distributed circumferentially on the end face of the workpiece. Here, I'm using a small dividing plate for clamping. With its help, dividing the circle is no longer a difficult task. Although its accuracy is not high, it's sufficient for my current needs. I'll be converting this dividing plate to a powered one in the future. Before officially drilling the holes, I need to make center holes to prevent the drill bit from wandering. Here, I'm using a 5mm diameter center drill. Then I'll switch to a 2.4mm drill bit for these M3 threaded pilot holes. To ensure the holes at both ends are perfectly aligned, I must drill them straight through in one pass. I cannot drill one end, turn the part around, and then drill the other end. The length of these cylindrical parts is 24mm, which means the depth of these holes is also 24mm. For a drill bit with a diameter of only 2.4mm, that is a very deep hole. Here I'm using a peck drilling method. I retract the tool by 1mm each time to remove the chips. I'll stop to clean the chip buildup on the drill bit when necessary, to minimize the impact of chips and reduce the chance of the bit breaking. But even with all these precautions, I still have to be very careful while drilling. If the drill bit breaks inside the hole, the part is scrapped. After drilling one hole, I also have to be extremely careful. It's when I rotate the dividing plate to align the next center hole with the drill bit. If the drilling process requires a calm mind, then aligning the holes with the dividing plate requires absolute precision. If the position is off by a degree or two, the drill bit won't align with the center hole, and the bit will either break or the hole will be drilled crooked. In either case, the part will be scrapped. Fortunately, everything went smoothly, and none of my worries came true. The next step is to tap the drilled pilot holes. I'm using the motorized tapping machine I made in a previous video. It's been improved since then. Originally, it was only powered by a power adapter, but now it can also be powered by a power tool battery. Although the tapping machine saves me effort, tapping is still a task that requires my full attention. I have to stay focused, especially with small threaded holes like M3. If the tap breaks in the hole, it also means the part is scrapped. After a highly tense session of tapping a total of 68 threaded holes, the most difficult parts were all completed. I can finally breathe a sigh of relief. Next, I'll make the ears for mounting the hydraulic cylinders. I'm using an 8mm thick, 200mm square aluminum plate as the blank. I'll program the tool path and use the CNC router to machine them. Since this router has an aluminum plate structure, its rigidity is not great. I set all the machining parameters very conservatively, so it took nearly 4 hours to finish. Afterward, I used the tapping machine to tap the holes, but I've skipped that part in the video. What you're seeing now is a group photo of all the finished ears. Additionally, I need to machine some shaft parts. I chose 8mm and 6mm diameter smooth shafts as my raw materials. I'll use my industrial wizard, the angle grinder, to cut them to approximate lengths. Then, I'll put them on the lathe to face the ends and machine the circlip grooves, and that is it. While I was machining the metal parts, my 3D printer was also working overtime to make other plastic parts. A few parts were too large to fit the printer's build volume. However, I just needed to rotate these parts slightly in the slicing software, so their longest side was along the diagonal of the print bed. This maximizes the diagonal print travel and allows them to be sliced and printed successfully. After all the parts are finished, it's time for assembly. This is the part I dread the most. Any design mistakes can be exposed here, leading to delays, rework, or even the whole project being abandoned. These heat-set threaded inserts are for the outermost 3D printed decorative parts. I need to embed them into the pre-drilled holes in advance. The first step is to assemble the boom. I'll combine the aluminum frame plates with the innermost 3D printed parts. Then I'll install the cylindrical connectors and the ears on this side. The parts for the other side of the boom are assembled in the same way. Then, I'll put the two halves together and tighten the screws to firmly fix the aluminum plates to the cylindrical connectors. With the main structure of the boom assembled, I need to install two small ears at its front end to connect the stick. The innermost 3D printed part of the boom already has heat set threaded inserts embedded. The outermost decorative parts can be installed onto it with screws. The structure of the stick is similar to the boom. This is the ear for the stick. Its installation is a bit different. First, all the parts for this ear need to be assembled into a single unit. Then, I'll install this unit onto the stick's aluminum frame plates. After installing the decorative parts and aluminum plates on the other side, the stick is assembled. Next, it's time to assemble the bucket. These heat-set threaded inserts are for mounting the bucket teeth. To improve wear resistance, I also need to embed brass bushings into these holes. A POM spacer needs to be placed in the gap between the bucket ears and the stick. The circlips on both ends of the shaft also need to be installed. Here, a POM spacer is also used between the two aluminum alloy parts. This is an I-type cylinder connector. However, I'm using it on a hydraulic cylinder here. The connector also has POM spacers on both sides. After the bucket and stick are assembled, I'll connect the stick to the boom. Finally, I'll install the whole assembly onto the excavator's chassis. that's a wrap for this video. Thanks so much for watching all the way through. If you enjoyed it, please hit that like button and let me know what you think in the comments below. In the next episode, we'll be building the hydraulic system. See you in the next one.